a message that being a servant leader is in all of you. Thank you, and God bless.
Good morning. Hi, my name is Shankar Sitaraman, and I'm from southern India. Excuse me. My wife is African American, and we try to teach our son both Hindu and Christian values and stories. But he seems to be getting most of his education from the Marvel stories. He loves Spider-Man, Iron Man, Black Panther, and the rest of them. So I told him that in our Hindu mythology, there are lots of superheroes and supervillains. And now he wants to know more about them. He's like, read me stories about them. And so I want to tell you a small story from the Ramayana. It is one of the most important Hindu epic stories with over 24,000 verses. And Ramayana means the story of Rama, king of Ayodhya. He is an incarnation called Avatar in Sanskrit, of Lord Vishnu, born to destroy the evil king of Lanka, now called Sri Lanka. Ravana has worshipped Lord Shiva and acquired many superpowers. Superpowers, weapons, and he even has a magical airplane in which he kidnaps and takes Rama's wife to Sri Lanka. But in his pride, he forgot to acquire immunity from humans, because he thinks no human can beat him in battle. Rama and his ragtag army of forest denizens, they have to cross the ocean to get to Lanka, and they start building a stone bridge. Even the squirrels want to help out by taking little pebbles and grains of sand and adding them to the bridge. Others start laughing at them, but they persist in their efforts. "What are you doing? You're only getting in the way," they told the squirrels. But the squirrels say they really want to help in the process, and they appeal to Rama. Rama intervenes and tells everyone to respect their efforts. They may be smaller and weaker, but their contribution is really important. The grains of sand and pebbles that they're adding fill in the gaps between the stones and make the bridge stronger. Our work requires the efforts of everyone. He then thanked the squirrels and caressed their backs with their fingers, and thus the squirrels got the lines on their backs. And it's actually true. If you see squirrels in India, they'll have lines on their backs. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. That means peace be unto you. I'm honored to recite the first surah of the Quran, Al-Fatiha, the opening. These verses are for guidance and mercy, which we absolutely want for our students. I will recite it in Arabic and then English. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm ad-Din. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ittina surat al-mustaqim, surat al-azina amta alayhim, gairul maghdubi alayhim waladdallin. The English. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, all praise is due to God, the Lord of the worlds, the Merciful, the Beneficent, Master of this day of requital. It is you who we worship and you who we ask for help. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those upon whom thou hast bestowed favors, not the path of those who go astray, nor those who go astray after hearing thy teachings. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Exodus, chapter 40, verse 15. Let us hear the word of the Lord. Anoint them just as you have anointed their father, so that they may serve me as priests. Their anointing will be to a priesthood that will continue for generations to come. May the Lord add blessings to the reading and the hearing of the Holy Word.
At this time, we will be having our Beacon Liturgical Dance Ministry to come at this time. Thank you.
He leads me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right. And sometimes, the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it due to things that's happened in the past, hurt, abuse. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul. May this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. I have my sister, Leandria, here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
Cause all I seem to do is hurt me, hurt me. Lord, deliver me, cause all
my people who are called by my name. I'm holding face, turn from their wicked ways. I will hear from heaven. Break it on down. So it is. It is so. Amen. Now when we pray, we want to end that with a declaration, a decree. So I'm speaking for all of you listening, starting here, starting now. The things that hurt you in the past won't control your future. Starting now, this is a new day. This is your exodus. You are officially released. Now sing it for me, Leandria.
This is my exodus.
Yeah.
Let's say amen. Amen. Give God thanks for Rankin Chapel's Beacon Liturgical Dancers. Ushers, you may allow those in the vestibule to enter. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds for prayer. Let us be still before our God. Let us allow our minds and our bodies to relax in God's spirit. I said you close your eyes if you can. Ask for everyone to just be aware of your breathing. And let us breathe in God's love. Let us feel God's peace. Let us breathe in God's love. And let us feel God's peace as we exhale. Good time to give thanks for even the gift of life. Let us pray. Thank you. most gracious and loving God, before any human hands touched us, you already knew us. You can hear our thoughts. You can feel our feelings. You know us, and still you love us. Thank you, O God, for loving us. In this moment, O Lord, and in all our moments, help us to know your love. Help us to feel your love. Help us to know, even in this moment, that you are a healer more than you are a judge. And in those moments when we think only of our mistakes and our failures, when we are harassed by guilt over what we did or failed to do, when no one calls our names, holds our hands, or affirms our dreams, when we feel as if life is passing us by, and we don't know what to do. In those moments, oh God, rescue us from ourselves, from what we say to ourselves. Save us from feelings of helplessness. Instead, oh God, help us to feel and to know your love and to just trust your love. Remind us, oh God, that we can trust your love enough to be patient while you're working things out for our good. To trust your love enough to hold on to you when our minds cannot comprehend what is happening within us or around us. To trust your love enough to not give up on our dreams and to settle for anything less than what is in our hearts to do. To trust your love enough, oh God, that we will never give anyone or any situation the power to make us feel as if our desires don't matter, or that we do not matter. To trust your love enough to believe that everything is going to be all right, even when it feels so wrong. And while we're trying to figure all of this stuff out, oh God, do not let our insecurities, our weaknesses, and even our sins hurt those around us. Trusting in your love now, Lord, we give to you the people in our lives who need more than we could ever provide. Touch them right now, oh God. We give to you all who are being impacted by global warming. We give you this nation and the nations of your world. Help us, oh God. Show us the way to make our global community a true community. A beloved community. We're not going to tell you how to do these things this morning. We're just going to let go now. And we're going to trust you. We're just going to trust you. Hold us now. Hold us in your love. Until we learn how to love. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning again. We're going to change the order of service. But before we hear a word from our president, I'd like to acknowledge the presence of Mr. Paul Montero, Jr. Paul Montero, Jr., Director of the U.S. Department of Justice Community Relations Service and the former assistant to our president. Please stand. We also have with us Mr. David Bennett, our director, our senior vice president for development and alumni relations, doing tremendous work. We also have with us a former grad assistant. I continually make my grad assistants sit on stage when they come back to visit. And this is Dr. Carla Braley, former Democratic National Chair, Interfaith Council co-chair, and former vice chair of the Texas Democratic Party. My. And now also professor of sociology at Texas Southern University. Amen. And she was a candidate for lieutenant governor this past year. Amen. So proud of the work that she's doing. And this is a very special occasion for so many reasons. One of the reasons being that President Frederick has announced his retirement from Howard University. Really? I'm so glad my students tell me what to do all the time. Carla, nothing has changed. Dr. DeBroy is here. Where's Dr. DeBroy? Where is she? Oh, please stand. That we can not acknowledge you. I see you. And I'm telling you, I shared with some alums the work that this administration is doing is just tremendous, remarkable. We just thank God for your leadership and things that are happening here. They're unprecedented, and they have been able to rise to the occasion in such tremendous ways. We give God thanks. This is indeed special because President Frederick has announced his retirement. I refuse to really acknowledge that, but nevertheless, he has said that he is retiring. And I just give God thanks for the work that he has accomplished. Many of us, many of you have heard from this pulpit that we often fail to recognize greatness when greatness is close to us. And one of the reasons that we don't fully understand greatness is because we don't really grasp what greatness is about. President James Cheek, a former president of Howard University, reminded us when I was a student at Howard that greatness is achieved not by what one possesses, but greatness comes from what one believes in because of what they pursue and because of what they cherish. President Frederick believes and cherishes the mission of Howard University and has pursued a calling to make this great university even greater. He has answered this call, and Howard University has become a better university under his leadership. You can clap. Amen. You can clap. One of the things that we did when I was a student, and I hope that this new generation of students will do likewise, that we listened to our elders those who had accomplished a lot. And I remember receiving a call from Mr. Vernon Jordan. This was before you were president. And he said, I just had lunch with Wayne Frederick, and he is special. And he affirmed this understanding of greatness. Marion Wright Elderman, another elder, national, international leader, said of President Frederick that he walks in the spirit and the likeness of Benjamin Elijah Mays. That's high praise. And I told Marion, I said, Ms. Elderman, that's high praise. And then I remembered what Howard Thurman would say. He says, our elders would put a crown over our heads, but it would take a lifetime to grow tall enough to wear it. But yet we still must acknowledge greatness when it's in our midst. And I want to thank you, President Frederick, for your understanding of greatness and the work that you are doing here at Howard University. And we will not talk about your retirement. Amen? Amen. Let's give God grace. God praise for President Frederick. Following a selection from the chapel choir under the direction of Dr. Eric Poole, soloist Anaya Smith and Zion Lane, a duet, we will be blessed to experience the preaching and the ministry and the leadership of President Wayne A.I. Frederick. Pray for him as he comes to bring us a word.
morning. Good morning. I'm grateful and humbled to be here with you all today. I first have to bring regrets from my daughter, my 16-year-old junior, who absolutely loves chapel and couldn't be here this morning. She ruptured her ACL on the 25th of August and had surgery a couple of weeks ago. Is traveling to New York with me later today, and I'm sure some of you could relate to this. She said either she could come to chapel or she couldn't go to New York, or she could go to New York and not come to chapel. And then when she found out she could listen in while getting ready to go to New York, she decided she'd take that option. But I bring her regrets. Less than 24 hours ago, I was in Winston-Salem at Wake Forest, sitting in the middle of the Demon Deacons, rooting for the Blue Devils. The irony of that, I can't tell you, isn't lost on me. My son plays for the Blue Devils, and they beat the number one team in the Demon Deacons at Wake Forest 3-2 yesterday. But in standing there, I realized I got up three times to cheer the goals in the middle of the Demon Deacons with everybody looking at me. They sent their mascot over to tap me on the shoulder to try to get me to sit still. And so I tried to explain to him that I was a bison and that I didn't think that the Demon Deacons or the Blue Devils could withstand the pressure of the bison. But we'll see. I'm not sure they'll let me come back, though. This is my first opportunity to address a full chapel congregation without restrictions or limitations since the onset of the pandemic. And as I stand here filled with gratitude, I'm also reminded of the ways in which our lives were disrupted and the suffering we all endured during the past few years. So like Dean Richardson, I'm not going to talk about my retirement. But what I'm going to suggest to Dean Richardson is I don't think the president should address the chapel ever again. It's the only part of being president that I absolutely wish that he would change, but I know he's not going to listen to me. And having been an altar boy in an Anglican church, I certainly feel very strongly about the people who should come and speak here. But like I said, I'm sure he's not going to listen to me. So I'm going to ask you to bear with me for a few moments. Now that the threat of the pandemic has been largely diminished, it is only natural that we should attempt to revert to the lives we knew, the ones we had before. But that would be a missed opportunity. Yes, as an African proverb says, however long the night, the dawn will break. But whether that dawn will be a prelude to a new day or a replica of yesterday depends on the actions we take. The author, Arundhati Roy, has said, historically, pandemics have forced humans to break with the past and imagine their world anew. This one is no different. It is a portal, a gateway between one world and the next. We can choose to walk through it, dragging the carcasses of our prejudice and hatred, our avarice, our data banks and dead ideas, our dead rivers and smoky skies behind us. Or we can walk through lightly, with little luggage, ready to imagine another world and ready to fight for it. And so it is in this moment of uncertainty our society is ripe for change. There's no doubt about that. Yes, we have been tormented by loss and suffering in a multitude of ways and on a scale many of us had never encountered before. And the disorder of our world as a result of the pandemic has been difficult, to say the least. But however many challenges we are facing right now, it is incumbent upon us to make use of this disorder rather than work to banish it completely. So it is my ultimate hope that the pandemic fosters a change in perspective, one that drives us away from the notion of ownership and towards the concept of stewardship. In many ways, ownership runs counter to Howard's core values of service and selflessness. When we see ourselves as owners, we draw no distinction between us as individuals and the institutions we are a part of. Any action that benefits me will benefit the institution in equal measure, tends to be our motto. We want to change, shape, and alter our institutions in our likeness and according to our personal needs. Of course, institutions are created to serve people, but they are meant to serve people collectively, not individually. We cannot fixate too intently on assisting one person to the detriment of the others in our community. Stewardship, on the other hand, implies humility and selflessness. We should strive to give more than we receive, or rather, we should aim to return more than we take. What we receive should always be a passive result of the service we provide. When considering stewardship, I'm reminded of a passage where the mother of James and John asked Jesus a difficult question. She pushed him on her knees and asked that her two sons be allowed to sit on either side of Jesus in heaven. Then came the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, "What wilt thou?" She saith unto him, "Granted these two, my two sons, may sit, the one on thy right hand and the other on thy left in thy kingdom." But Jesus answered and said, "Ye know not what ye ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They say unto him, "We are able." And he saith unto them, "Ye shall drink indeed of my cup, and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. But to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared of my Father." Jesus' response illustrates two key points. First, that rewards require sacrifice. And second, that those two spots were not his to give. While they were indeed going to endure the baptism, he referenced the ultimate decision as to who sits in those places of honor will be left to God the Father. When the other disciples heard what was being discussed, they are said to be indignant. In verse 24, it says, "And when the 10 heard it, they were moved with indignation against the two brethren." It's easy to imagine that some found the entire request to be inappropriate and vain. And it's not hard to imagine that some of them might have been upset because they desired those seats for themselves. In this moment, Jesus uses the dialogue as one of his most teachable moments, reminding the disciples that worldly powers are usually the ones who lord authority, titles, and prestige over the people. Jesus makes the case that they shouldn't strive to duplicate such castes. The radical narrative of Jesus, an omnipotent God who sends his only son to earth in the form of a human being of low estate, was always focused on serving sinful humanity. Every step of his journey was designed to upend the earthly system of human value and a sliding scale of which ones mattered more. Jesus' purpose in coming to earth for the redemption of sinful mankind was essentially one of service. "But it shall not be so among you," he said in Matthew 20. "But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many." So in this moment where the mother of two of his disciples are concerned with who sits in seats of honor, Jesus delivers the admonition that the greatest among them would be he who served all. We should all be humbled by the idea that our time on this earth is transient, that we are merely a blip in the history of this planet, this country, and the institutions we serve. Our purpose is to steward the institutions we love from one era to the next. We must take that which we inherit and endow it with strength and vitality so that we may pass it on to our descendants. For 155 years, Howard has been providing a service of incalculable importance to our society. It is a duty of all people who walk our halls, students, faculty, staff, and alum, to ensure that Howard is stronger the day they leave than the day they arrive. Howard University's motto of truth and service makes it clear that this is an institution designed to benefit other members of the human family. Howard has always envisioned as a place that would illuminate the world far beyond the hilltop, and our ethos of service permeates so many facets of the enterprise. Academic institutions are here to amplify other people's humanity, and I don't think there's another academic institution in this country that has done it better than Howard University. Howard's unique origins, orientation and mission remind us that it was never meant to be an institution to ennoble some at the expense of others, or recreate the broader society where there were clear winners and losers, or favored and unfavored. Our School of Law is known for the quote of Charles Hamilton Houston, that a lawyer is either a social engineer or a parasite on society. No one person owns any portion of Howard University. No one person is entitled to or owed anything from Howard University at the expense of another or the institution's mission. At a time when Black America and many marginalized communities are in need of services and social change that only Howard and our fellow HBCUs can provide over the course of generations, we would do well to focus more intently on the question, am I being a good steward? On this particular Sunday morning, we have also gathered for the Student Leader Commissioning Service. And today we are called to welcome our Howard students, especially those who serve in formal and informal leadership capacities on campus. After a month of being back at the Mecca and acclimating to our new schedules, the chapel reminds us of the importance of leadership. When we set foot on the campus of Howard University, one of the highest points of elevation in Washington, D.C., not only are we standing on hallowed ground, but we are also standing on the shoulders of giants who came before us, leaders whose work must be nurtured and furthered by the next generation. And that leadership beckons us towards stewardship, more so than ownership, because embedded within the concept of leadership is humility and selflessness. The idea that we lead not out of any selfish motivations, but rather for the sake of others and the world we inhabit. As representatives of Howard, we don't have the luxury of studying simply to pass the time or satisfy our idle curiosities. A Howard diploma is an agreement between university and student that the education given and received will be put to use toward the betterment of our society. Howard grads have many paths before them that they may choose to follow. If they are so inclined, they also have the skill and the knowledge to blaze a new one entirely. And while each path will venture in different directions and through distinct challenges and with numerous ultimate destinations, they should all be pushed from behind and pulled forward by the same clarion call: service and leadership, stewardship, not ownership. Certainly to some, especially those in power, the Roman Empire must have seemed right and orderly. After all, it was a land where leaders were expected to lead and servants were expected to serve. But to Jesus and his followers, it was a world that was nonsensical. The hungry were not being fed, the sick were not being cared for, and the poor were not being given charity. How could civilization exist when people's basic needs were not being met? And as it is said in the book of Mark, chapter 10, describing the same encounter with the mother of James and John that I referenced earlier, "But many that are first shall be last, and the last first." Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are guarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and give his life as a ransom for the many." So Jesus didn't lead for the sake of self-fulfillment. He didn't lead for ambition. He didn't lead to become rich. He led in order to ensure that the hungry were fed, the sick were brought back to health, the poor were given care and support. To Jesus and his followers, the world that society accepted was upside down, and they led simply to make it right. So too often that leadership can be seen not as a means of service, but as an avenue for personal gain. But a leader is not defined by who finishes first, or for that matter, who finishes last. And so the more we strive to come in first, the more destined we are to come in last. The more we try to personally come out ahead, the more likely we are to come up short for ourselves and for others. The secret to Howard's record of culting servant leadership has less to do with how we recruit or how we train our students, although certainly those aspects are important. We concern ourselves less with leaders who are born or made and more with what they are called to do and achieve. And the most successful servant leaders are those who are awakened to their purpose in life, that mission for which they are uniquely suited. We don't ever want our students to turn away from their passion. We simply teach them how to steer their ambition in the direction of service to others rather than for personal gain. So Rankin Chapel, through programs like Day of Service and Alternative Spring Break, and all that it does throughout the year, has taught us that we must be more than leaders. We must be more than servants. We must be servant leaders, leaders who are dedicated to service, and servants who are willing to lead. We must combine the boldness of leadership with the humility of service. And we have to be both audacious and meek, determined yet flexible, ambitious but always selfless. So as we approach homecoming season and focus on the access, privileges, and perks of who was seated in places of honor, recognition, and accolades, it's important to remember that this is an institution built squarely on a foundation of service. As such, we must remember the responsibilities attached to calling oneself a bison, and the enduring obligation to use the education obtained here to uplift others that the broader society may never have regard for, so that no one is also left behind. So may we all be good stewards of Howard University for the sake of the communities we live in, the country we rely on, and the world we inhabit. For I am probably the ultimate beneficiary of Howard's love and its magnanimity, because I came here as a freshman student, 5'8", 86 pounds, with all my clothes on and my large Diodoras, with sickle cell, and Howard University gave me my life in more ways than one. And for that, I will always be grateful, and for that, I will always serve her from near and far. And so, I'm gonna close where I think all leaders should close, and we should acknowledge those who try to serve us, but recognize that we are here to serve them. And so I would like Erica, my assistant, to stand so I could acknowledge you. Erica is from Fort Worth, Texas, and political science student via North Carolina. So I want to say to you, thank you very much for your service today. Amen.
Let's give God thanks for our president. Let us not only be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. Howard University is indeed a special place, and I still get excited. I share with some of my classmates, Mr. Manton, I see you, Chauncey Manton, my roommate, but these students are at another level. They are brighter than we were. They're just so much smarter, so much with a heart to serve. I get excited. I get excited when the members of the Residence Life Court came in holding hands. Stand up. I just want to acknowledge. I know I'm breaking protocol, but I want you to stand up so we can acknowledge you. And they came up this morning. Thank you. And the Royal Court, when they come, I get excited. Please stand just for a moment, just for a moment. I know I'm breaking protocol, but that's okay. But I get excited. Thank you. I get excited. We have a somewhat new ministry in the chapel. It's the Juvenile Justice Advocates. And under the leadership of the President Davina Scott, is she here? Where are you? Yeah, please stand. And they just finished 2 weeks of training. Any other juvenile justice advocates here? Oh, my, beautiful. But they just completed 2 weeks of training, and we had almost 70 students come out to serve in a detention center in Washington, D.C. That's amazing. So they come with a heart to serve. And I'd like to thank also their supervisor, Dr. Nisa Muhammad. Please stand. Please stand and we can acknowledge you. This great student body has a tremendous leader also in the Vice President of Student Affairs, Dr. Cynthia Evers, who has a tremendous responsibility. And I'm going to ask her to come forward this time to share an occasion for us.
Good morning. As Vice President for Student Affairs, it is my distinct honor to join you for this year's Student Leadership Commission. This occasion not only highlights your role as a leader, but also provides time for us to reflect on what we can accomplish together. As I look out among the many faces in the room, I'm reminded of the sense of group, belongingness, and togetherness that fills our Bison community. Today we join in recognizing and congratulating student leaders who have gathered to make Howard better and stronger together. As student leaders, you are reminded that students, faculty, and administrators are better when we work together and invest in our future. Student leadership is an integral part of success for the Howard University community. Therefore, you must remain courageously committed to sharing your gained wisdom and experience. You are special because you have shown that your goals extend beyond your self-interest. You are ready and eager to take on tasks which call for personal sacrifice. You spend countless hours in the pursuit of enhancing the student experience. Your energy, inquisitive minds, your sophisticated grasp of the important issues of the day, and your belief that the impossible is only a little more challenging to reach is a testament to who you have become and serve as a beacon to the students who look to you for guidance. To the student leaders, I wish you joy, growth, and purpose as you work. Plan, organize, communicate, share, help, and support with the goal of accomplishing better things together. 1 and 2 Corinthians teach us that we are to work together. Howard University teaches us that we are better together. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Evers. I've shared this many times with the Howard University Student Association president, but I also get excited when she speaks. What a gift and what a leader. I bring before you the 62nd president of Howard University Student Association, Ms. Jordan Allen.
To Dean Richardson, chapel staff, and friends of the chapel, President Frederick and all cabinet members present, Vice President Erica Annabelle Clark, and to all members of the Howard University Student Association, including the executive, legislative, judicial branches, councils, and all good standing organizations. Good morning. Morning. My name is Jordan Allen, and I am blessed to serve you as the 62nd president of the Howard University Student Association. It is my honor to provide the response to the charge this morning. Whether you are an elected student leader, appointed members, or staff of this beautiful organization, there is something truly empowering about being called to lead at an institution like Howard University. And before I continue, I think it's important to acknowledge that we are all HUSA. HUSA is not just myself and Erica Annabelle Clark, but it's every organization on this campus that moves in truth and service. Built on the principles of truth and service, Ms. Howard University has long stood as an institution that has nurtured and developed leaders that go on to change the world. Yet before you launch into an international leader, you have been seen here and noticed here and ignited here to create the same change right here on the yard. But going to a competitive institution like Howard, where everyone is a leader and born to make a difference, it is easy at times to sit and wonder, how in the world did I land this position? And am I even worthy enough to be called to make a difference? We all go through it. Look, I went through it. I remember my freshman year, I ran to be a member of the Howard University Student Association Senate, won my seat for the School of Business, and was truly just excited to be a part. I've always been a very vocal individual and committed to serving my constituents, so I ran for vice chair as an outgoing freshman and incoming sophomore. I won the seat and just couldn't wait to serve. About a month later, the chair stepped down, and if you know protocol, the vice president serves in the absence of the president. So honored, I stepped up. There I was, a freshman, and now the youngest freshman to serve as the chair of the Houston Senate. Look, once again, I was just excited to be there. But then I started to receive doubt in my abilities from members of other branches, trying to guide me in an attempt to violate the theory of separation of branches. And although I came in confident in my abilities to serve, I started to question whether or not I was qualified or meant to operate in such a space. And here's my charge to you. As you are commissioned today, remember that God qualifies you and not people. I don't care how many votes you received or how many people you networked with to get to your position. If God did not write your story or ordain your steps as such, no vote could ever supersede his. Which brings me to my favorite Bible verse. I shared this with our chapel family a couple weeks ago. Esther 4:14, perhaps you were created for a time such as this. As you lead throughout the year and cross tribulations and tough decisions, and if for a second you experience a looming fear that you are not fit to leave or serve, recall how Esther was just a Jew in a Persian palace during a time where there was a decree to kill all the Jews. Esther was placed in a position to rescue all of her family from death, and in that moment she could have shrinked. But she knew that God sovereignly positioned her to make a difference in a time such as this. So when things get hard throughout the year, or others doubt your ability to leave, to lead, or even if you dared to doubt yourself, remember, you were all created for a time such as this. Thank you.
My, my. We are truly blessed, aren't we? And, we have leaders not only on this stage, but leaders out here in the congregation. And we're just truly blessed for this particular moment as we begin our roll call. We're going to have Mr. Glenn Vincent, Assistant Vice President of Student Affairs, to come, who is very special to the chapel. For many years, he was a grad assistant with Dr. Braley and also led our alternative spring break program. He is truly a leader of leaders. And we're going to ask Mr. Vincent to come at this time to, with our roll call of student organizations. When he calls your name, the group name, I'm going to ask that you stand for at least 5 seconds so that we can film appropriately. So count to five before you sit back down.
Good morning. At this time, I will call the organizations, and once again, please do not get me in trouble. Make sure you at least stand for 5 seconds. Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, Alpha Chapter. Alpha Kappa Psi Professional Business Fraternity, Incorporated. Alpha Phi Omega National Service Fraternity. American Institute of Architecture students. Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel Beacon Liturgical Dance Ministry. Clinical Laboratory Science Society. College of Arts and Sciences Council. College of Engineering and Architecture Student Council. College of Nursing and Allied Health Sciences Council. Collegiate 100 of Howard University. Alpha Chapter, Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated. Diva Incorporated. Educational Psychology Student Association. Generation Action. The Gentlemen of Drew Social Club. Graduate Student Council. And Dr. Muhammad, help me with the name. Juvenile Justice Advocates. Howard Rugby Club, Women's. Howard University Alternative Spring Break. Howard University Bison Catholic. Howard University Chapel Assistants. Howard University Coalition for Good Trouble. Howard University Elite Models. Howard University Film Organization. Howard University Florida Club. Howard University Nutrition and Dietetics Club. Help me out there. Howard University Residence Life Court. Howard University Royal Court. Howard University School of Divinity Student Government Association. Howard University Sports Medicine Society. Howard University Student Association Senate. Howard University Transfer Student Association. HU Rotaract. Men of George Washington Carver Incorporated. Muslim Student Association. My Sister's Keeper Howard Chapter. National Council of Negro Women. National Society of Black Engineers. Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated Alpha Chapter. Revolt Incorporated. School of Business Executive Council. School of Education Council. The Black Girls House. The Black Women and Pre-Law Society, Howard University Chapter. The Writers Guild. They might have to help me with this one. You help me with this one real quick. Okay, UQuelly, thank you. UQuelly, the Howard University Undergraduate Research Journal. Thank you for the save. Wesley Foundation at Howard University. Women of the Mecca. Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated Quintessential Alpha Chapter. Did we miss any organizations? Okay, NAACP. Okay, the Executive Branch of Howard University Student Association. And do we have any representatives from UGSA here today? Okay, thank you. Okay, and just the Divine Nine? All of them. Okay, that's it. Thank you. Thank you all so much.
Student leaders, please stand. Mr. President, I present to you the student leaders.
And so, Mr. Vincent, UQuelly is the undergraduate research journal started by undergrad students and run by undergrad students, just to clarify.
All right, thank you.
All right. As student leaders of campus organizations in the Howard University community, you are faced with an awesome task. Each of you has accepted a challenge to be a student leader and has become an active participant in a rich legacy, a legacy that has made Howard University a global beacon of hope and promise to a proud people. Will you be faithful to this great legacy? As student leaders of the Howard University community, will you seek to serve in a spirit of excellence with compassion, integrity, and bold commitment to justice in your diverse pursuits?
Will you help me step forward to continue the legacy of service at Howard University and throughout the world? Do you promise to remain faithful to this legacy, serving in a spirit of excellence with compassion, integrity, and bold commitment to justice?
Howard University community, I commend to you these students whom we this day recognize as student leaders for Howard University and all communities throughout the diaspora. I commission you to serve and lead Howard University and to share your gift of leadership, commitment to academic excellence, and passion for truth and service with the world.
We accept this commission,
charge, and the prayers of the people.
We are the change we hope to see. Through faith, service, and justice, we are the future right now.
Congratulations.
I'm going to ask now, as we stand just for another moment, I'm going to ask the President of HUSA, please come down front, Chapel Sister President Monica. I'm going to ask a few representatives from the different organizations to stand. One of the traditions that comes out of the Black experience in the Black church is the praying over the elders, the elders praying over our leaders. And I'm going to ask our vice presidents to come forward at this time. Please, representatives from student organizations, please come as we pray over you. I'm going to ask if the president would not mind coming down to pray over our as they stand in front, will you pray over them? And I'm going to ask members, some alums and members of the community to come forward to pray over our elders, our students. Just come forward. I'm going to ask Mr. President and the Vice President to be in the center right there. Yep, in the middle. And you are surrounded by elders. You're surrounded by leaders. And these leaders have confidence in you. They have faith in you. And they understand that you will continue this great tradition at Howard University, that you will be for us and for the people that you have been called to serve. Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, those who you have entrusted to take up mantles of leadership stand before us. We thank you for their desire to serve. We thank you for their gifts and talents, their creative ideas, their new dreams and visions, and the energy that they are bringing to Howard University. Much has been given to them, and so much is required. But you created them, and you called them for such a time as we are living. We ask now, O God, that you bless these student leaders and the organizations they represent. Bless their agendas, their hopes, their dreams, and bless their lives. May they remember to seek not greatness, in the words of Benjamin Mays, but seek to serve. And in seeking to serve, they will bump into greatness along the way. Give them understanding minds and compassionate hearts. May there be prophetic and courageous voices among them, a voice for all who have not a voice. Make them wise enough, strong enough to confront their own weaknesses, to learn from those who came before them, and to handle their giftedness with humility. Rule and overrule any passion that seeks to place their personal agendas and ambitions over what is good and what is right. Give them courage for the times when their commitment, their faith, their desire to do what is right will cause them to stand alone and even to stand hurt. Remind them, O God, to be on the right side of history. They will spend time on the wrong side of public opinion. May they find the strength and the courage to always choose integrity over popularity and to seek to serve others and not themselves. May they come to know the joy that comes from serving. And while they're serving, may they experience the gift and the joy of having friends. Friends who they will laugh with, friends who they will cry with, friendships that will last a lifetime. Oh God, before you are those who will help to shape our future. May they walk worthy of this calling and responsibility, and in conduct and in character. Help them to be models of excellence and reflect the very best of who we are as a people and as a university. We thank you, O God, for these student leaders. We thank you for Howard University. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let us return to our seats as we process. I have to say this. We talk a lot about Howard University, but this can only happen at Howard University. It only happens at Howard University. You are special, but you're special for a reason. You have been called to do great things. So we give God thanks for this marvelous experience. We give thanks for our president, Rain Frederick. That's right, you can clap. Amen. Thank you, O God, for what eyes have seen. We thank you for what our ears have heard. We thank you for what our hearts have felt. And now I said to the one who stood at the gate, give me a light that I may go out into the darkness and into the unknown. And she replied to me, go out into the darkness. Go out into the unknown. But put your hand in the hand of God, and God shall be for you better than light, and much safer than a known way. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Let the church say amen. Ha ha ha.